confirmed number of cases of the coronavirus in Los Angeles County today comes to 75,084. The confirmed number of deaths reaches 2,959. Here in Torrance, the total number of confirmed cases is 457, with total confirmed deaths at 50. Welcome to COVID-19 Today. I'm Hiba Samath. It's 4 p.m. on Tuesday, June 16th. President Donald Trump signed into law executive orders regarding national police reform policies. The order includes the creation of a national police misconduct database, as well as new guidelines for use of force and de-escalation, and proposes an increased role for social workers and mental health professionals in responding to a variety of issues. At a press conference today, Trump said he met with the family of Ahmaud Arbery, as well as the families of Antoine Rose Jr. and other victims of fatal police shootings, in the process of drawing up the executive order. Trump said he was taking executive action to encourage police to adopt the highest and the strongest professional standards to deliver a future of safety and security for Americans of every race, religion, color, and creed. It was a milestone moment for the LGBTQ community as the Supreme Court ruled in favor of gay and transgender rights. The landmark ruling now extends protection to millions of workers nationwide that argued that the 1964 Civil Rights Act that bars discrimination based on sex did not extend to claims of gender identity and sexual orientation. According to UCLA's Williams Institute, the lesbian, gay, bisexual, and transgender community is made up of approximately 1 million workers who identify as transgender and 7.1 million lesbian, gay, and bisexual workers. California lawmakers passed a $143 billion general fund budget yesterday. State lawmakers were required by a constitutional amendment to pass a budget by Monday's deadline or forfeit their pay. The bill they passed includes major revenue raisers and other state tax law changes. The budget that passed will serve as a placeholder for the fiscal year beginning July 1st. The budget framework will be amended as they plan to continue to negotiate with Governor Gavin Newsom. The bill was approved 61-13 in the Assembly and 29-11 in the Senate. With both chambers controlled by Democrats, lawmakers are hoping federal aid will step in before triggering spending cuts. Legislative leaders haven't been able to come to an agreement with Governor Newsom to close the $54.3 million deficit due to the health pandemic, some arguing some of the proposed cuts to public services would disproportionately harm the state's most vulnerable. Both sides are counting on a bailout from Congress, but disagree about what to do should none materialize. While lawmakers adopted many of the strategies the governor proposed, such as tapping into reserve accounts, temporarily limiting corporate tax credits, and borrowing from special funds, they did not agree with taking steep cuts to education and safety net programs. Now, the college application process is changing rapidly for the class of 2025 as many universities announce foregoing standardized test requirements. Harvard College is the latest to join nearly 200 schools, including some of the most selective in the country, to forego the SAT and ACT tests for future applicants. Harvard joins the University of Southern California, Caltech, all nine UC schools, Cal State Universities, Boston College, Dartmouth, Scripps, and Cornell are just some of the colleges that will no longer require SAT and ACT test results for next year's seniors. As testing dates in the spring and summer were canceled, the College Board, which administers the SAT, requested that colleges and universities show flexibility when it came to admissions testing, requesting a shift towards a temporary test optional policy. As surprising as the news comes, this may not have as big of an impact. According to the Pew Research Center, only a handful of schools in the U.S. are actually highly selective. Just under 50 schools have acceptance rates less than 20%. These schools represent about 3% of the U.S. colleges and universities. More than half of U.S. colleges admit two-thirds or more of students who apply, and many public four-year universities are open access, meaning they don't have competitive admissions or exams required. Last month, the UC system voted to phase out the SAT and ACT altogether, citing that it will consider new assessments and requirements. Traveling by plane will require passengers to wear face masks going forward. Many of the major U.S. airlines like American, United, Delta, and Southwest announced plans to roll out new policies to include wearing face masks enforced with a penalty as severe as possibly a ban on flying with that particular airline. United announced today for at least the next 60 days, those who refuse to wear a face mask starting Thursday could be placed on a restricted travel list. Now, if you happen to forget yours and don't have one, United says they will offer you one, while flight attendants will do their best to de-escalate the situation and try to enforce the mask. If the passenger does not comply, an incident report will be filed, which could impact the passenger's future flight benefits. Updated policies for crew members are also expected to be announced in the coming days. Nursing homes across the country are under fire as thousands in the U.S. have yet to be checked out by authorities to ensure staff are following proper procedures and protocols to prevent the transmission of the virus. The House Select Subcommittee launched an investigation into the ongoing COVID-19 crisis and nursing homes with concerns that many are undersupplied with protective gear and many cases underreported. Currently, more than 40% of California's COVID-19 related deaths are attributed to nursing homes or senior care facilities. Now, facilities across the country face losing federal recovery funds if inspections are not conducted before July 31st. A letter was sent to the Centers for Medicare and Medicaid Services, the federal agency charged with monitoring nursing homes, as well as the country's five largest for-profit nursing home companies seeking documentation and information including COVID-19 case and death counts, staff levels and pay, legal violations, and efforts to prevent further infections. The letter also asks for information on how the federal emergency funds have been allocated to healthcare providers. Legislators said they hope this process will provide an opportunity to have productive discussions on ways to work together to protect the vulnerable population. Nearly 1,000 restaurants in Los Angeles County were found non-compliant this past weekend. Health inspectors visited more than 2,000 establishments and found that half were not following safety rules meant to curb the spread of the coronavirus. LA County Public Health Director Barbara Ferrer says some of the owners were confused about the new rules that needed to be in place. She said tables should be at least 6 feet apart or have a physical barrier. Restaurants are only allowed to reopen at 60% capacity, with staff wearing face masks at all times, and diners wearing face masks when not eating, and patrons waiting for their tables outside. Inspectors will be out again visiting the restaurants that were not in compliance to ensure they've made modifications. Otherwise, they will be issued an order to come into compliance. Members of the public can also report businesses that are operating without safe protocols in place. Those can be made online on the County of Los Angeles Public Health website. Speaking of restaurants, the city of Torrance is proposing a pilot program for local restaurants at tonight's city council meeting. In an effort to assist restaurants in the downtown Torrance area, the city is proposing to create an alfresco-style dining experience offering sidewalk and parklet dining options. Here's a mock-up of what one of the streets in downtown Torrance could look like if the city approves this pilot program. Parking lot event permit fees would be covered by the business assistance program. The pilot program is proposed for the summer months of July through September and only on the weekends. The Office of Economic Development, along with Public Works, General Services, and Community Development, would help facilitate the street closures, city's insurance and security, and provide communal dining tables. This would allow restaurants who are currently limited to serving at 60% capacity to increase their ability to serve more customers. Currently, there are 20 businesses in downtown Torrance interested in participating. You can tune in tonight to find out how the City Council votes on this proposal. The outdoor dining pilot program is just one of the many agenda items to be discussed at tonight's City Council meeting. Members will meet on Zoom to discuss city business. The City Manager and Finance Director will recommend the City Council adopt the proposed revisions to the 2021 operating budget. The City Clerk will also recommend that City Council review applications and appoint a member to fill the Planning Commission vacancy from the list of qualified candidates. And the Community Services and Community Development Departments will recommend recommend that the city adopt an ordinance prohibiting oversized vehicles and trailers from parking in the various city-owned public parking lots. Staff will also recommend adopting resolutions that restate the Torrance Municipal Code bail schedule for misdemeanors and infractions and parking penalties. Council members will also get an update of the city's ongoing recovery efforts from COVID-19 and consider options for responding to orders from the County of Los Angeles and the state. You can view the agenda online now. The community is encouraged to participate by emailing ahead or calling in during the meeting. You can do so by emailing councilmeetingpubliccomment@torrancea.gov. And during the meeting, you can call 310-618-2404. The meeting can be seen tonight beginning at 7 p.m. live on City Cable, as well as over the air on 25.2 online at torrancea.gov, Facebook, as well as on YouTube. Just a month away from the extended tax filing deadline, the Internal Revenue Service is reminding the public that resources are available online to ensure filings are turned in on time. Due to COVID-19, the IRS pushed back the April 15th tax filing deadline to July 15th. Officials say the sooner you get your returns in, the better to avoid penalties and interest. Now, despite the pandemic, remember that tax professionals are still working, and if you need help, you can still contact one. Make sure you have your W-2, 1099, and 1098 forms ready as well. Also, copies of medical receipts if you're itemizing and claiming a medical expense deduction. For those who can't file by the July 15th deadline, everyone is allowed to request an extension to file their return. For more information, head to irs.gov. Amid the coronavirus crisis, one organization is shifting gears and moving from in-person to online free tax assistance. The American Association of Retired Persons, or AARP, is offering their services to help Americans with filing taxes. The AARP's Foundation Tax Aid, which is the nation's largest volunteer-based free tax preparation service, is providing free online tax prep assistance through its tax aid program right now through the July 15th deadline. You can request the help of a volunteer coach in preparing your tax returns. Officials say the virtual method serves as an alternative option to the program's traditional in-person services. While many of their clients are over the age of 65, tax aid provides free tax preparation and filing services to all taxpayers. Officials say the pandemic has had a devastating impact on older adults' finances, especially with those with low income. Now, volunteers are trained and IRS certified every year to ensure they understand the latest changes to the United States tax code. To find out more, head to aarp.org. As unique graduation events, drive-by diplomas, and social distance goodbyes take place this month, we want to continue celebrating our class of 2020 and your big milestone. Whether it's a preschool promotion or college graduation and every milestone in between, send us your photo and let us know what school you're graduating from. We'd be sure to show it on our show. Email us at COVID19today@torrancea.gov. With Father's Day coming up, we want to celebrate dads, father figures, and other men in your life. Email us a photo of your special person, his name, and we'll be sure to share it on our Father's Day show that's coming up on Sunday, June 21st. Well, before we go, at the end of each program, we like to share stories from our community, feel-good pictures, images, and videos that remind us of how resilient our community is and reflect how Torrance truly cares. Tomorrow, the city will host its annual blood drive, and this year, with the coronavirus still a threat, many past blood drives canceled, it's that much more important for the community to consider donating. If you think you could be a blood donor, go online to register and make an appointment, as walk-ins will not be allowed this year. Your 1 hour of time could possibly save several others. Go to redcrossblood.org and click on schedule an appointment and use the sponsor code City of Torrance. With several dozen city employees scheduled to donate tomorrow, it's just another way we're seeing how not only residents but employees continue to show how Torrance cares. Now, if you have a great story or have pictures or videos that you'd like to share or just want to say hello, please email us at COVID19today@torrancea.gov. Stay informed by signing up at torrancea.gov/torrancealerts. Subscribe to City Cable's YouTube channel and be sure to like the city's Facebook page. That's our update for COVID-19 today. We hope you'll join us again tomorrow at 4 p.m. as Rihanna Trutanich joins us live to bring you the latest updates. Be safe, stay healthy, and thanks for tuning in. We'll see you next time.